Okay, so we are back with Cornelius Schumacher. I hope I pronounced that right. This time you're here as a representative from Deutsche Bahn. But in case we have listeners who didn't pay attention last time, so perhaps you should introduce yourself once again.
Yeah, sure. So I'm happy to be back. Last time we talked about KDE and the KDE Free Qt Foundation, so that's basically where I'm coming from, working in the community, in the KDE community, but generally in the open source community for many, many years. And I've done that as a volunteer job, basically from the beginning, and I never stopped doing volunteer work in this area. But I also got into the open source business, if you want to call it that way, also relatively early, working for Linux distributions. I worked for SUSE Linux for a long time. And nowadays I'm working at Deutsche Bahn, the German railway company, at the IT daughter, DB Systel, and I have the position there with a nice title, Open Source Steward. So I'm kind of combining a lot of the experience I gained over the years in the community and then the industry regarding open source into this role, which brings things together, I would say.
So Steward, Open Source Steward, is Steward the title for people walking around in the trains? Assisting people. So does your title reflect the train aspect of your work?
That's actually an interesting question. I don't know exactly how this title was created. So that was before my time. So this was the title of the job description, basically, before I joined. Normally, I think in other companies, especially in the English-speaking world, you would call that an open-source program office in some way. So that's effectively what I'm doing. So the tasks and the responsibility is similar to that, what you would anchor and expect in an open source program office.
Cool. This is something we're discussing quite soon. One private thing here, you did write Contact, the KDE tool, didn't you?
I did write parts of it, yes. So I was part of the founding group. Contact is interesting because it's a combination of several applications, and I was the maintainer of K-Organizer, the calendar part, and then we threw things together to create Contact as an integrated suite. Was a really interesting project, actually. Maybe a topic for another deep discussion.
Okay, cool. So about Deutsche Bahn, is it a company or is it like an agency?
So we are the big railway company in Germany, so with more than 100 years of history. So it's a huge group of several parts. So we are operating the net, but also operating trains, and it's owned by the state. So from this point of view, it's I think it's a pretty unique company. It's huge. So that's also it's one of the biggest companies in Germany, depending on how you count. And obviously, I mean, running trains in all of Germany takes a lot of people and takes a lot of effort. So that also is the scope of the company is of course quite big there.
Cool. So what kind of software do you do inside Deutsche Bahn?
So in terms of software, sometimes you wouldn't expect that, but of course you need a lot of software to run the whole system, and that's for sure. So from the software which is in the trains, through the software operating all the infrastructure, doing all the scheduling, selling tickets, but then also of course also all the software which you need to run such a company internally for accounting, for everything, and not all of that is open source. Of course, but open source is becoming bigger and bigger. And also the software part is becoming more and more important because using software is the only way to make these companies efficient. So that's this digital transformation I think a lot of companies are facing now. And for such a company with a lot of history and a lot of heavy metal running on the tracks and so on, it's sometimes not that easy to move into this digital era. But on the other hand, there's also a lot of opportunity, and so it's really exciting to see what is happening there. Software plays a big role there, and I think what we observe in all corporations is that once you start using software heavily, you will automatically also get into the question of open source software, and you will automatically get it, and it's everywhere. So you have to deal with it in a good way to, on one hand, manage the risks which are associated with that, but also on the other hand, to take advantage of the benefits which come from using open source software.
Do you also use sort of open source to standardize software within the industry? I mean, there is a lot of attention on being able to book international train trips and things like that. I guess you need API standardization or a lot of scraping, depending on how you build it. But do you have any open source efforts in that direction?
That's also a very interesting question. I think Deutsche Bahn is an example for a company which is not primarily a software company, obviously. I mean, it's not like a Microsoft or a Google or Facebook, which are basically software companies running their business, where software is the prime product in the end. So for us, it's a means to an end, and we need software to actually get our jobs done and manage the business. And so... From this, I would say we are not at the forefront of open source development ourselves. It's something which is not as central to our business, I would say, because we have a lot of other things to take care of as well, where also a lot of innovation and everything is needed. But software is becoming more and more important. And these standardization effort, what you see in other industries, I think that's also a matter of maturity. So you have to do one step after the other. You can't just jump in doing open source from the start in a strategic way, switching everything to open source. That would just not work in such a complex and big company. So it's a matter of maturity, starting with being aware of open source software, control how you use it, be in control of what is happening there. Also then starting to contribute, starting to also publish your own projects. And I would say we are on this path of becoming more mature with it. So we use it a lot, and we are starting to contribute. I wouldn't say we are there yet with this strategic use of open source to set standards. It's also a very complex area, and of course there are tons of standards, and there's tons of standardization from all kind of different angles going on there. And also, of course, proprietary vendors are implementing standards and stuff like that. So it's, I would say, Deutsche Bahn is an example, I think, for these companies who, gain experience and take more and more advantage of open source over time. And we are certainly not at the forefront of what you can do there, but we are getting there and graduating in our literacy with open source more and more.
Do you use any, when you procure software, do you have some kind of clauses that you prefer free and open source software?
I would say at the moment it's something which is individually handled. So it depends on the cases and what we are doing there. It's also... Deutsche Bahn is a huge company, so there are lots of areas which are working there. Also, we are organized in a way where we have a lot of independent or kind of independent companies. So they all have their own procedures, they all have their own legal entities, and so it's hard to find these general rules, or it doesn't even make sense to have general rules for everything. So it's again, I would say a matter of getting more and more mature and spreading the knowledge about how you deal with open source software in the most effective way.
Cool. So you mentioned contribution. Do you contribute upstream in the name of Deutsche Bahn, or do you do that privately?
So we do that. We actually have a contribution process, which is public as well. So we have published our open source contribution policy on GitHub, which I think is a really nice move to make it transparent also as an example for other companies and to also get into this discussion about how you do that, how you handle that. And that's actually something I personally also enjoy, getting in these conversations also with other companies to learn from them. And because, as we know, open source is a thing where the rules are the same for everybody. You don't negotiate an open source license, but you take what is there. So there, this community exchange of ideas and experience and so on, it's quite valuable. And we are trying to contribute there, especially in these areas where it's interesting. I think a lot of companies are in this situation that they are now getting their feet into the water of open source slowly and step by step, and they have to learn how to do that. So good examples are always nice to have, especially practical examples or things which are not only theory but are practiced and done in reality as well.
Did you have discussions with your lawyers about contribution and liability and stuff?
Of course, yeah. I mean, that's that's part of the fun of my job, handling the open source topic from this more general point of view, like on a company policy level, there you have to look at all the different perspectives. I mean, we have the legal aspect, we have economic aspects, we have technical aspects, we have the community. So you have to look at all these angles and bring that together. And that's part of my job is exactly this. Building this bridge or serving as a bridge between the legal questions and the people who are qualified to handle them and the people who are doing the technical work, and bring that together. And obviously, when it's about policies and rules and so on, then these have to be in place, have to be go together with all the other compliance work we have to do with the laws which are there, with the internal regulations and everything. So talking to lawyers is a good part of my job, and I actually enjoy that. It's fun.
If you look back over the last period, so who is usually the toughest to convince, the financial department or the lawyers or developers, perhaps?
I couldn't say that there is a group which is harder to convince than another. I think I've seen it in all groups. Sometimes you have lawyers who don't understand open source, but if they do it, it's easy to work with them, or can be easy to work with them. Same with developers. I mean, there are developers who are very deep in open source, who understand all the different implications of licensing and development practices and how this interacts and so on. So that's very easy to work with. But then there are also developers who I don't know, just don't have experience with open source or have a simplistic view on how open source works, so that also can become difficult. Sometimes it's difficult to convince people that it's okay to contribute something to the public, because they don't feel like they are entitled to that, or are just not experienced with that. Or on the other hand, sometimes it's the other way around. So you have to explain to people that there are some rules you have to follow, and you shouldn't ignore the license which is in the repository you are using and stuff like that. So from that point of view, it's a very, I think it's a wild mix of challenges you have to overcome there. And these are on all sides.
Did you see that you had to make changes in the way that your development organization works in general? Some background to the question is that my reflection over procuring open source rather than procuring commercial contract is that it puts more integration responsibility on your table, or even if you pay for the integration, you will end up with something that you need to maintain. So it puts higher requirements on your own engineering organization as well.
That's certainly a part of it, yeah. I think there are lots of challenges there, and the interesting thing about open source software is that it comes up in all kind of different areas also where you might not expect it. So when you buy a product, so and in the past you would just buy it and not think about open source software, and suddenly you buy products which consist mostly of open source, which also come with their own challenges. Or then you have the alternative of for some use cases you can maintain it yourself or run it yourself and buy support or not buy support. So there are so many different constellations that certainly makes it harder. And I don't have the complete full picture there what is necessary to really do that in the full way, because again, in a huge company it's hard to change structures, but it's happening. That's actually one interesting detail about DB Systel, the company, the daughter company where I'm working. We went through a full agile transformation over the last few years. So a lot of structures have changed, and a lot of ways how we approach work and collaborating. It's becoming more less a hierarchical system and more working in a network and getting the people who you need to do the work, getting them together in a still structured way, but I would say more flexible way. And this, of course, it's a challenge to go through such a transformation, but that also opens these opportunities to work with these things in a better way.
Are you moving in like an inner source direction, even for your sort of internal development, or is it just a coincidence that it sort of it sounds as if you're ending up closer to that?
Yeah, inner source is a topic for us, obviously, also because I think it just makes sense. Collaborating within a big company, there are silos, of course, there are barriers, there are boundaries between different legal entities within the group and so on. So the topic of how you actually collaborate, how can you use the software you develop internally, that's a question which where inner source is provide some answers, and we are also working on that. We actually have written an inner source license. That's also something we published. I think I talked about that last year, and that's one tool, I would say, a mechanism for us to make sharing within the group. On one hand, obvious, but also on the other hand, regulated in a way which fits our internal needs and what we need to do there to do that properly.
I'm curious here. Do you have education within the company for developers, for lawyers, for financial, etc.?
Regarding open source, you mean? Mm-hmm. Yeah, to some degree, that's something we are also building up, doing more of that. I think that's essential for any company to have this knowledge about open source and being educated about it. Yeah, I think many people bring some knowledge there, but of course, we need a systematic approach to make sure also that the people who are dealing with open source software know what they have to be aware of there, especially when it comes to compliance and these kind of questions. Of course, yeah, you need to be able to answer the questions or to find the questions you need to ask at the right point in time. So that's something where we are in the process of building up trainings and stuff like that. So
cool. You mentioned compliance, so I'm interested if we start by looking at we classify the software you're doing. So one would be like services, or it could be also internal use, and then we might have external things like Android apps. So if look, discard the internal stuff and look at the services. So when I'm booking something online, so do you have any policies there on what licenses are okay and not okay?
the policy, it's hard to answer this question with, is the license okay or not? I think that's because you have to consider the usage scenario. You have to consider, is it used internally? Is it used externally? Is it something which might actually be internal and might move to an external point at some time? Also, depending on how you use it, for example, Linux obviously is a system which is everywhere. Once you use the cloud, you run a lot of things on Linux, and Linux with the GPL license is something where a lot of people would say, oh, this license might be difficult because I might run into trouble there. But then using an operating system is something different than copying a GPL library and modifying it. So from this point of view, you have to look into the details. And that's what we are trying to do, actually, to build up the policies in a way that they, on one hand, fit our usage scenarios we have, also the typical usage scenarios we have, and then give guidance about what questions to ask and what answers to give there to be able to decide. And that also comes with consulting, of course, and helping people and helping teams to understand what is needed there. So that's actually a big part of my job, answering questions about licenses and similar things.
Cool. So it's like a use case based policy. So
yeah. So I mean, as I said before, we are not a software company as primary purpose. So we are not in a situation like Google, for example, where the wrong license in the wrong place would compromise the whole company. So I think we. Not sure if we are more liberal there. That's probably the wrong word, but I think that the risk is it's a bit the risk is different than in such a situation. So we are trying to deal with that in a reasonable way, I would say. So we're not banning licenses just because they are a license, but we are looking into the cases where they might be used and then take decisions how to do that.
Yeah. I really like the phrase you used earlier where you said a heavy metal company. So you're actually getting paid to work with heavy metal. That is like right. A dream for me. Okay, cool. Do you actually do apps for mobile phones?
Yeah, there are actually a number of apps. I mean, they're it's a whole zoo of apps. I would say the big one, of course, is the DB Navigator, the app you use to get your schedule or to buy tickets. So that's obviously the app the customers of Deutsche Bahn all know. But then there are also other apps to help with stuff like accessibility or more information. So one example is the Bahnhof Live app. So Bahnhof, the German word for train station, which is an app which gives information about train stations, like schedule and like information about what shops are there, opening hours, maps, and all that. So everything you need when you are at a train station. And this is an example for an app where we actually have released the core of the app also as open source software. So that's an interesting project where people can look into how this is done and or what we are doing there, and also are able to contribute. It's kind of the attempt to also get on the level of the users, get closer with the people who are using our apps, and have more ways to interact there in a way which are beneficial for both sides.
Cool. What license did you choose there?
So our usual license when we publish things is the Apache license. The Apache license is a permissive license, which is very open. So only few complications which are happening there. For the software we publish at the moment, it's mostly these kind of more infrastructure software or frameworks or something like that. So smaller things or things which are not the where you wouldn't build a business around selling the software in a way. So if you want to do that, then the Apache might have some disadvantages. licenses, but as an open license to share things, enable collaboration and that, we think this is a good license, especially as the Apache license is well-maintained and well-defined. And that's something which I think is quite useful. And obviously, it's a popular license, so many projects are using them. So our approach is not to be special, but to go with the flow and do what everybody else is doing successfully as well.
So you didn't end up writing your own license?
No. So I would never dare to write an open source license. I think that's generally a bad idea.
The thing is that every now and then we bash a Swede who wrote the program curl for writing his own license. So I think it's about time to do that now. So why on earth do people write their own licenses? So that is done now. Have you experienced a lot of the old classic FUD, fear, uncertainty, and doubt within Deutsche Bahn?
I wouldn't say so. In general, my feeling is that maybe it was a decade or maybe also two decades. The decade of FUD is more or less behind us. I mean, it's not completely true, of course. There are still people who are not believing in the concept or who are might risk some business or reputation or whatever. But in general, I think the general understanding of the benefits of open source and also that it's not this hippie idea of abandoning copyright and let everybody do whatever they want, but that it's actually a solid way of developing software, but also a solid way of doing business. And with all the software vendors adopting open source as a means to do their business, obviously the interest in spreading FUD has vanished more or less. I mean, what I see is that so if we look at some companies who fought against open source software before, I mean, they did that because they didn't use it and they were in danger of losing. But at the moment where they realized that the freedom you get with open source is not only a threat, but also an opportunity. And that if, as a company, I use open source software, I actually get the freedoms which come with that. Then as a company, you get a lot of benefits and you can take advantage of that. And we see that. I mean, the cloud runs on open source software. I think there is no other way how you could build these kind of systems. And so when you are running a cloud in some way or running cloud software and you enjoy the freedoms of the open source software you use there, that's good for your business. And from that point of view, I think the motivation to spread FUD is not as big anymore. So it's more about the practicalities, how to do it. And obviously, I mean, what we also have to see is that there are some risks which come with open source software, and making sure that you are license compliant, that your software is secure, that you are in control of your supply chain, you know what is happening there, that you have the support you need, and so on. So these are questions which in parts are more challenging with open source software. So you need to build up the mechanisms how to deal with that.
Are you involved in any collaborations around this? I'm thinking if there are any groups or organizations that you can recommend working with or that you have experience from. Apart from KDE, then, of course, but I guess that's less applicable.
Yeah, right. Yeah, KDE is a specific part of software, so that's obviously not a general organization for dealing with open source. But I mean, we know the big organizations, which are the Linux Foundation, the Eclipse Foundation, the Apache Foundation. I think these are all organizations which are, especially for corporations, these are good partners because you get this neutral ground where you can interact with other companies in a way which is regulated and fine, and you need to get the experience and the exchange. So that's actually also part of what I'm doing, being active in the Linux Foundation. There's the to-do group, the group which collects people running open source program offices and developing material around that. So that's one group where I'm active. Another group I'm following is OpenChain, or where I'm also a little bit active. OpenChain as I think the most important project at the moment for corporations if they really want to be in control of their software supply chain. So I think that's very important. And then also, of course, more informal gatherings of open source people. There are tons of opportunities. And this networking, I think, is also one of the powerful factors of open source, that you can actually deal with people which work for other companies in a way which is beneficial to all of us. And that gives us this power of the power of the many, which is at the core of open source.
I have to ask, are you a member of the Open Innovation Network or Invention Network?
The Open Invention Network. At the moment, we are not. That's obviously also, a very relevant and important organization, which has done a lot for keeping the freedoms of open source and making sure patents are not threatening it. In some way, they have achieved what they wanted to do, right? I mean, I think the patent threat also is quite different than it was now. And with companies like Microsoft joining, against whom do you want to defend yourself if everybody is a member already?
Cool. I shouldn't say I can imagine, because I probably can't imagine the amount of data that you have. But how much of your data is open data when it comes to timetables? It's a bit outside open source.
Yeah, but I think it's very relevant, because I always consider these different areas where you can apply the concept of open as something which belongs together. So be it open data, be it open hardware, open content, open anything. I mean, there are so many things where you get the ideals of open source and apply them in different areas. And open data is a topic that's actually something where Deutsche Bahn also was active already quite early. So already for a couple of years, we have an open data portal. We have hackathons around open data. We publish open data. How much it is really hard to tell, because, as you say, there is a lot of data, obviously, in the company, and we certainly don't publish everything. I mean, it's still only a small part of what is really open. And that also, of course, has good reasons. I mean, you can't publish anything. So from this point of view, there is data available. And we are doing that for a couple of years already. And what I also like is that there's a community which makes use of this data, and we are not the only transport provider who is publishing that. So in the open mobility community, or whatever the correct term for this group of people is, I think there are lots of interesting people and also lots of interesting projects which are doing interesting things with the data. And this can be quite simple, like OpenStreetMap. So there's a variant OpenRailway Map, which has all the railway data there. You can just see that. And that's, of course, easy, because you can just look up where the tracks are and put it on a map. So this is kind of open by physical necessity. but then we are also publishing data about train stations, for example, and stuff like that. So yeah.
Cool. So I'm waiting for for you personally to make it possible for me to book a train from Gothenburg down to Berlin. So that's your next task.
So is that still a challenge?
I think it is. But it may be on the Swedish side.
You can do it summertime. I think that's the thing. I'm not sure if it's Swedish side or German side, but you go
as far as I know, the same train is during winter goes up north and during summer it goes like down south. I don't know,
but you have access to the IT systems, you just make it happen.
Yeah, this idea of making things work together and this interoperability, these standards which enable everything. I mean, that's something where, of course, open data, but also open software, open standards all play a role. So I think it's an opportunity. Then, of course, you need to manage somehow the collaboration between all the different involved parties. And the bigger it gets, the more difficult it is, obviously.
I'm a bit curious. You mentioned that you provided open data, and you said something about like some communities there. Do you have resources set aside to communicate with these groups?
There are resources. I think it's. I wouldn't know how to position that because I would say if you run open source projects, for example, I mean you need to allocate resources to be able to maintain them and to organize community and so on. So if we really have targeted efforts there where you want to achieve specific project goals or create communities and so on, I mean that's one of the things you always have to consider when you're doing open source, that there is effort you need to kind of put into the project as kind of activation energy to enable the collaboration which then benefits. And from this point of view, it's necessary. But we don't have dedicated groups or teams which are only responsible for that. So for that, we are not doing enough really specific projects of this open source work. I would say it's often part of other roles, part of other initiatives where we are working with people in the community or working with other companies and so on. So that's, I think for us, it's a general principle. Also for me, when I said my role is basically equivalent to what you are doing in an open source program office, we don't have an office there. We don't have a dedicated team which only does that, but it's more like a distributed, a virtual team, a virtual effort where we work with the people who are on the specific topics or have the specific expertise, and then we are getting them together where they are needed. So it's less dedicated, but more maybe on the side or as part of your regular tasks or what you're doing there.
Cool. How did I figure you saw an ad somewhere for this job, or do you have how did you get involved with Deutsche Bahn?
That was the power of the community again. So some people approached me and said, "Yeah, this might be interesting for you." And then I realized, okay, I know some people here and there. So people I met in the community, and so it was like that. So kind of an organic thing, If you're looking for open source people in Germany, I mean, the group is small enough that you can know a lot of them. So I think I have a good overview just by being there for more than 20 years now.
Yeah. Cool. So I think we have a pretty good idea on Deutsche Bahn. Oh, what do you say, Ivan?
Yeah, I think so too. Is there anything else you want to add? Something we forgot, Cornelius?
I mean, I think there are tons of things which, when you get into the details of how you are doing something like that, going to something which still is new in many ways, using open source software, contributing to open source software, there are so many details. And I think what for me, on one hand, is the interesting part and the challenging part, what also excites me, but also sometimes can be tough to deal with all the details, is that you have to deal with all the details. So bringing all these things together, and there what I really appreciate is that the community builds practices which make it possible to deal with these details, be it like the Open Chain project, but also having standard licenses, also organizations like the OSI, which makes sure we have a definition of open source licenses and maintains that. And I think that this is all very valuable. And I'm really grateful that we have this community, which is active and where people are doing this work of getting some order into the potential chaos, which open source can be. And from that point of view, I think it's very important. So that's also where I'm personally trying to help, where I have some influence, but also where I'm grateful to the other people who do a lot of this, sometimes not very thankful work of keeping things clear and have good rules and have a good setup so that we can rely on that. So that's something which is I think about that quite some time, and I'm always happy if people are making also the projects out there, the open source projects, are making it easy to use their software and are not complicating things by, I don't know, changing licenses or other interesting things you can do there.
But it's kind of fun that you mentioned this sort of sharing knowledge, because it seems like, I think you said the word digitalization in the beginning, and I mean, it's the same problems everywhere. So me and Henrik are currently in automotive. I've done some work around appliances, home appliances, and you're in a heavy metal train company band. So it's, and it seems to be the same issues that you bump in everywhere, and there are common solutions.
Yeah, but it's funny going back to like 20 years when I started with computer. Oh my God, it's even longer. So when you had to explain free and open source software, and B, you were like almost ridiculed. It ain't gonna work. It ain't gonna work. And but it's cute you're doing this. I love your style, blah blah blah, and now it's part of every company's every day-to-day business. So there you go.
Right.
Epic win.
I told you.
So now we're just waiting for the year of the Linux desktop.
It will come. It will come, I'm sure.
Yeah. We will provide some link. I'm curious about the Deutsche Bahn contribution process. You, the inner source license, is that also something that you have available?
Yeah. It's all on GitHub. We have a repository there, open source policies in the DB Systel organization on GitHub. There we have published the contribution policy and also the inner source license.
Yeah, we'll collect all that and put it in the show notes. I also noted down you had an open data portal, so we'll make sure to collect that one and get it in the links.
Super cool. So on behalf of PostNord, we thank you for being our guest one more time. And perhaps we should do a follow-up in like a year or so. See you, to put pressure on you on your progress.
To see if you can, the night train goes.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. If you see if you can book your ticket then.
Yeah. I figure that the main transport within the company, the preferred way of traveling would be by train.
Absolutely.
Okay, so cool. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.